my name is Katie. Welcome back to my channel. This is the second video in my writing craft book series. today we're talking about Wired for Story by Lisa Cron. Be sure to check out last week's video about writing irresistible kid lit that goes into like your character and your plot and middle grade and young adult and the market and all of that good jazz. Everything's going to be linked down below once everything's out. And again, my notes that I have for this are notes for me. You might get more out of this in certain spots that I didn't need. We all read and we all need different things. So, this book, being scientific that it was really blah for me to get through. I really wanted to skim and then I would realize I probably missed something important. it's hidden well, but it's so like blah blah blah, and I feel like there's a ton of words that could have been summed up better. But she's really trying to get across her examples and all of that, so like I get it. It just wasn't my favorite style of a craft book. Save the Cat and Romancing the Beat are much easier for me to read. What I do like about this is that there is a checkpoint at the end of each chapter. So it's basically a chapter summary on if you did just want to read those and get through the book a lot faster, because it's also like a chomp in like 250 pages. So each chapter shares a cognitive secret and a story secret and how they contradict each other or go with each other or whatever. And chapter one is about how to hook the reader. And they break it down by what happens is the plot. Someone is the protag, the goal is what's known as the story question, and how he or she changes is what the story itself is really about. And that's how you hook the reader. So what is your book about? What's your story about? What's happening there? What's at stake? The takeaway that I got from this chapter was everything. Your subplots, weather, setting, tone, etc. must relate to and affect your protagonist quest. Everything. So you have to leave out all the boring parts. I was told this like on my first rodeo with writing a book and it stuck with me. I still had a meandering subplot line, but I've since learned the error of my ways, of which I talk about in writing Irresistible Kidlit. But I think it's so important, especially when you're first starting out, to know that everything needs to go back to your protagonist. Everything needs to go back to their like shard of glass and their misbelief, because that is why they're doing anything. And I'll cover more of that in Story Genius, and that one's coming out next week. But really, like, your protagonist and their why is what is driving the story, how they're gonna react, how they're gonna act, and everything needs to relate back to that. So then we have the chapter one checkpoint and we're going on to chapter two. This notes with the checkpoints is gonna be in the members only pages, so be sure to sign up for that newsletter if you just want a quick access at what those checkpoint questions are. Otherwise, go ahead and check out this book for yourself. Chapter two is how to zero in on your point. So the story is about the protag's issue, the theme, and the plot. It's not about whether they achieve their goal, but it's how they overcome internally to do it. Everything about these two books, both by Lisa Cron, are about your protag's inner struggle and inner journey and all of that. So everything's going back to internally, which I have thoughts about, and I'll put it in my last video. Or I think I'm gonna do a coffee chat also to talk about this topic, because I disagree a little bit. It goes into your themes and then talks about your tone and how, like, this was interesting. It said tone belongs to the author, but mood belongs to the reader. And I thought that was a really interesting sentence. And that's one of those, again, if you were just skimming, you might have missed that. So your theme begets the story's tone, which begets the mood the reader feels. And I think that was really cool. So then we do a checkpoint for chapter two. Chapter three is I'll feel what he's feeling. And this is basically like your brain, how when you read something, you're feeling what that character's feeling. And you want to make it known to the reader what certain things mean to your protagonist, how they're feeling about it. Each detail you share reflects and reveals something about your character. So it gives the example of like, if we know Anne is sad, we don't need a paragraph describing what she looks like when she's crying. Rather, body language should tell us something we don't know. What are they hiding? Where's the tension there? It works best when it's at odds with what's happening. That's especially true when you do dialogue and what you say means something different than how you're feeling inside and maybe what you're showing on the outside. Body language tells us what's going on internally. The next tidbit I got from this was write what you know emotionally. So it takes a spin on like write what you know and kind of debunks that, but it says write what you know emotionally. Tap into what you know about human nature and how people react, and then consistently show us the emotional and psychological why behind everything that happens. Again, this is just more internal, more internal. So then we do a checkpoint for chapter 3. Chapter 4 goes into what does your protagonist really want? A protag without a clear goal has nothing to figure out and nowhere to go. They're the ones driving the story, so you have to figure out what they really want, and it has to be something very specific. And your internal and external goals are at odds with each other, but both are driven by the same core issue that your character is struggling with. What fuels the external reaction is their internal struggle. And sometimes the external goal changes as the story progresses, and sometimes your internal stuff's gonna change a little bit too. So then we go into the chapter 4 checkpoint, talking about why and your protagonist, and chapter 5 is digging up your protag's inner issue. So this is where you're gonna find their misbelief and all of that, which again is talked about in Story Genius. So they said, like, both of these knock out the character profiles. They're like, that's way too much. We need to figure out the event in his past that knocked their worldview out of alignment, triggering that internal issue that keeps them from achieving their goal and the inception of his desire for the goal itself. So what key moment in the past made your character the way they are? This was super helpful for me when I revised Romancing Fate, and because she didn't really like have a back, like a reason why she was the way she was. And I gave backstory into her love interest as well for them to have had this past moment, which they didn't have before. And so that was a really good event to center on and have all her misbeliefs routed through. So chapter 5 talks about how story is often about a protag coming to realize what's really causing him to do the things he does. The things we do reveal who we are. And it talks about developing an outline, the premise, the why, differentiating the general from the specific in your story, the details, all the backstory, side characters, that mirror, subplot for contrast, a ticking clock. It just goes through all the things, figuring out the what, the how and when your character slash story will meet slash happen, the what if, which this goes into major detail about the what if. Like, you need to know what your protag is going to learn along the way, what their aha moment is going to be. And basically, like, do you know where the story is going? Do you know where your protag is taking that story? And then we have the chapter 5 checkpoint, and we go into chapter 6, which is the story is ending specifics. So sensory details should only be used to convey necessary information to the character slash plot. Try to leave out the parts that readers tend to skip. If you're reading a novel, pay attention to the parts that you're skimming. Pay attention to pacing that you feel is off. Don't do that when you write your own book. I know that there's plenty of flowery prose and like way too much description and details usually in a book that I skim over. Sometimes some of that is like totally important and gonna come back later and I'm like, what? But I don't want to do that in my books. So I try to like bare bones my descriptions, give enough for you to get a sense of the world, but like you also need to see descriptions through your character's eyes. You can't just be describing everything. You need to pinpoint stuff that their brain would notice. If it's a room full of stuff, maybe if they're a musician, they pinpoint the instruments or whatever. We go through chapter 6's checkpoint and we get to chapter 7, which is courting conflict, the agent of change. And so this goes, oh, I actually love the quote in this one. So it says, all changes, even the most longed for, have their melancholy. For what we leave behind us is part of ourselves. We must die to one life before we can enter into another. No, that was so cool, because every time your story ends, your protag has like ended a life, you know what I mean? And they're moving on. They have like learned and they're on their next journey. And I think that's how we each feel after we finish a book as well. So like basically story is about change, which results from unavoidable conflict. It's a battle between fear and desire, comfort versus change. Your protagonist is caught between two forces of versus. If it's their what they want versus what they have, protag versus themselves, protag versus antag, whatever, it's between two forces. In your story, will they face their biggest fear and resolve their inner issue? If not, you need a different story. They caution you to not make your big reveal at the end be a convenience or contrivance or coincidence. They want you to add little hints, little seeds along the way so that everything makes sense in the end and you're not just like popping out crap to make sense and make it believable. That way too, you've created tension along that whole journey. We hit chapter 7's checkpoint and then we go into chapter 8, cause and effect. And it says that our brains follow the if this then that process. And a story follows a cause and effect trajectory from start to finish. So our brain is constantly thinking along this storyline the entire time. And so it goes into this like pattern. And if it's like if then, therefore. And so it says your scenes should be action, reaction, decision. And this goes into this little bit I'm about to share, goes back into that show versus tell. So it says myth is show, don't tell is literal. And it says tell me John is sad, show him crying. Reality, show, don't tell is figurative. Tell me John is sad, show me why he's sad. And so it's that whole why. We need the characters' train of thought, their internalization, their competing desires, fears, and therefore choices. It's all character-based for these two craft novels. It breaks down what you need in a scene and then what you can ask yourself for cause and effect to help you with your scenes. It also wants you to take a serious look at your story and say, like, if I cut this out, would the story change? If not, get it gone. This is the whole kill your darlings thing. It also says something about like an and so test. And so like if you're, and so, if you're talking about something and you're like, and so, how does it further the story? What is the point of it? If you can't answer that, get it gone. So chapter 8 has their checkpoint and we go into chapter 9, which is what can go wrong, must go wrong, and then some. So we're putting your pro tag through the test. Even in her wildest dreams, she doesn't think she can pass these tests, but you're gonna get her there. It has 11 do's and don'ts for undermining your character's best laid plans. Again, this is in the notes. I'm gonna skip it for now so this video isn't super long, but it is in the members only section, so go check that out. We have the chapter 9 checkpoint, and we go into chapter 10, which is the road from setup to payoff. So it says three rules of this road is that there must actually be a road, and you can connect the dots. The reader must be able to see the road unfold. They need to know what happens on the page, not told. Number 3, the intended payoff must not be patently impossible. So you can't just like do something that was never, like they can't just like come up with superpowers at the end. Is everything logical, basically? Did all your dots build to the final moment? So chapter 10 has a checkpoint, and then we go into chapter 11. It says, meanwhile, back at the ranch. That's what it's called, and it's going through foreshadowing, flashbacks, and subplots. And it takes you through like how you can put them in there and the best way to do that, what subplots, flashbacks, and foreshadowings are, and how best to use them. That was a really interesting chapter to me. And one of the things in that chapter says, give your characters a believable reason for everything they do, every reaction they have, every word they say, and every memory that suddenly pops into their head and changes how they see everything. This is what subplots, foreshadowing, and flashbacks come in. So utilizing all those to make your story deeper, to go back into that why, to explain things if they're needed. They definitely say to like use minimal ones, you know, only the important ones, and only like when it's about to be needed. And then we have the chapter 11 checkpoint, and chapter 12 is the writer's brain on story. So it talks about how the writer's brain fits into the equation. They say that there's no writing, only rewriting, and that your first draft is identifying the underlying story you're trying to tell. Both these books go into the first draft and then like building on that. They never think you're gonna have a fantastic finished first draft. They want you to double check your characters, what they do in a scene, if it makes sense based on what they believe is true, and then given what they believe, how would they react or act in a scene. And then you get some feedback. So when you give your book out to a critique partner or a beta reader, they have 7 questions that they ask that you can send that person. And it's even like before you get to that stage, like alpha readers even, when you're just kind of going through your first draft on what you might need to improve on. So those questions are, what do you think is going to happen next? Who do you think the important characters are? What do you think the characters want? What, if anything, leaps out as a setup? What info did you think was really important? What info were you dying to know? And what do you find confusing? So that's what readers can answer for you once this first draft is done and out. If y'all have any more questions about this book, feel free to DM me or leave comments down below. The next week will be Story Genius, and we'll just keep on trucking with this whole internal goal and struggle of your protagonist and how they drive the story. I hope that this was helpful. I hope my critique was helpful and that y'all find something of use in this or through the notes on my members page. Happy writing and happy growing in your craft. See y'all next time.